Hey, this is Joey, and welcome to Clamshell Clubhouse, a movie hangout podcast where Whitley, Tanner, and I discuss cult films from the VHS era. Well, occasionally cult films, but what we really want to check out are those films we watch as kids constantly. Those VHSs that came in the puffy clamshell case? Yeah, you know the ones. Movies we'd burn out from watching over and over again. Let's see if those movies hold up and maybe learn some cool trivia about them along the way. You can find us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and the video version on YouTube. Thanks for tuning in, and now, here's the podcast.
All right. So, this week, we are doing, a special film. A special film mostly to Joey. Joey grew up on this movie. Joe, just...
This is the greatest film of all time.
Okay.
Why?
Please tell us why.
The music. The words, sheer poetry of comedic excellence that is this film. Yeah.
What's the name of this special film? What's the name?
This film, 1984, it's called
Ghostbusters.
Fuck yeah. Ghostbusters is the movie this week.
Yeah.
And the craziest thing I think about this one is that I had somehow not seen it in my life.
Yeah, that blew my freaking mind.
Actually, Whitley, had you seen it? Whitley had seen it.
Yeah, most sane people have seen it, Tanner.
Yeah,
most people have seen it.
Yeah, get a life.
Are
you excited to get a life?
No, what's funny is the only scene I remember from this movie, and maybe this just shows my character, who I am as a person, is the, ghost blowjob scene.
Yeah, I was just thinking about that earlier.
I only remembered that scene.
Well, I think that says more about you.
Yeah.
Than anything else.
Whitley's just shaking her head. Whitley's off camera shaking her head. But yeah, so Ghostbusters.
Ghosts.
Hello, Ghostbusters.
They're real.
You do? You have?
They're here. Ghostbusters.
Really embarrassing.
It's kind of a cool look. This, right here, this framing, it's got, the Warriors vibe whenever they're, close up and it's, tonight, the Warriors.
I've been asked to relay a request from the Gramercy Riffs. It's a special for the Warriors. That's that real live bunch from Coney.
I don't know if you've ever seen that.
I haven't.
But that's a good look.
I've seen Ghostbusters, though.
So we already talked about it's wild that I hadn't seen it. But really, what's cool is we're going to be going into the part of the podcast that we late in the game figured out that's what we're going to do. We're going to talk about movies from childhood that we would watch over and over and over again that we hadn't really seen much of since then. So we can kind of see if they hold up, if they're, still
good. Most of them won't, I'm sure.
Yes, some of them. Yeah, actually, probably most. And... also look up cool trivia, and it's kind of fun because even if we don't really care too much about the movie in the end, we still learned about things that were involved in the movie. And
we lived, we learned, and hopefully we grew.
Yeah, exactly. And this week it's kind of Joey's pick. It's a movie from his childhood, Ghostbusters.
Yes.
Which somehow
my dad loved this movie so much that I'm pretty sure the only game we had for Super Nintendo was Ghostbusters.
It was a Super Nintendo game? I didn't even know
that. Oh, yeah, bud.
Is your dad a Ghostbuster?
My dad is a Ghostbuster. My dad quotes Ghostbusters more than I do, and I do it quite often. So that's saying something. My dad loves this movie.
It is. I do like it a lot, and I am pretty depressed that I didn't see it as a kid because... it's definitely it would have been a great movie to watch as a kid. The movie feels like three guys playing make-believe.
Yes.
And
the whole thing is, too, is like Ghostbusters is probably the first movie I actually remember watching.
Oh, wow.
And as I got older, the jokes got funnier because I understood, started to understand.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So now it's just, it's immortal for me.
It's a home run.
It's
so the movie. All right.
Should we let Joey talk?
Yeah, I mean Joey can
tell us the movie.
So basically, the basic synopsis here. I can say it, or you can say it.
Hey, I want to hear your stab at it since
he's just reading verbatim like something from Ghostbusters fandom.
I could say it.
Yeah, no, I mean, no, that's probably the better option anyway. That's probably the better.
It's just because I might screw it up. So it's basically is. So it's basically, they say three misfit. I wouldn't say they're misfits. I'd say they're more like underdogs. They're more like,
yeah,
schlubby, yeah, kind of.
I feel like Bill Murray is Bill Murray.
Bill Murray.
Bill Murray.
Bill Murray is.
Bill Murray is he's like a schlubby.
Rebel. You know, he's like a rebel.
Rebel, yeah. Yeah.
He like doesn't follow the beaten path.
Yeah,
or, that's
right. He's going against the grain.
Yeah.
He's the dean of Bill Murray. Mm-hmm.
Really what it is, it's three guys. This whole movie feels kind of like a stoner comedy without any weed involved. They all seem absolutely just like kind of like slackers. They feel like, yeah, they are I can't pronounce this word.
Parapsychologists.
That's and right. They've gotten some sort of grant, right? They had a grant to where they could do all of their studies on at the Columbia University, right? Because they're like,
yeah.
They're using
Bankman or Bill Murray was a college professor.
Okay.
In parapsychology, but really he's trying to do anything to just like make a quick buck, kind of. Because I feel like his whole thing is that like he's just going along with it, and then he finds out that like it's like actually something happening. Like he's a parapsychologist,
yeah,
but like he really doesn't believe it. But he knows people are easily.
Yeah.
Easily duped into believing it. So,
yeah.
You know what I mean?
No. Yeah. And that does make, it makes more sense. We'll get into it. But like,
yeah,
the beginning of the movie opens up and we're at the New York Public Library, which is fucking, it makes so much sense that they would use that because that place is crazy. If you ever seen like videos of like the actual interior of like the New York, it's like an endless labyrinth of shit.
I was just about to say, it's like a labyrinth. Yeah.
It's crazy. We watched that video, Architectural Design, those people on YouTube, they did a whole video on the New York Public Library, which is kind of cool.
Really?
It's so crazy. But anyways, it opens up there and it's an older lady working as the librarian. She's going around collecting books in the library. And it's probably, this whole thing's going to be so funny for Joey because it's a person's first experience to a movie that
like,
everyone's seen 10 million times.
Yeah.
And I'm talking to the people that supposedly.
You're like, guys, there was like, a librarian.
There was a librarian.
She was putting those books back and there was a ghost.
It's going to be very goofy because there's not many people out there that haven't seen this movie. So it's a little weird. But the librarian's walking around. She's collecting books, doing the librarian shit. And spooky shit starts happening. Books start flying off the shelf. The
cards start shooting out of the...
Was it the Dewey Decimal? Was that what they're called? The Dewey Decimals? What's the library?
They're just reference cards, I think. Dewey Decimal System's the way they... arrange books,
gotcha,
that's true. Those are popping out and those kind of spook her and she starts running and she turns a corner and boom, there's just a bright flash.
Fun fact, Huey Lewis in the News turned down doing that.
Really?
Or Ray Parker Jr. did, yeah. And then they later on tried to sue Ray Parker Jr. To say that it sounded too much like I Want a New Drug.
Oh, what is that song? Like, what's it called? I Want a New Drug?
I Want a New Drug. It's like Huey Lewis in the News is like one of their biggest things. But
I'll throw that in right here.
Yeah, yeah.
So, boom.
But yeah, it doesn't sound anything like the Ghostbusters thing. So but anyway.
It felt, that song feels like a Prince song, kind of. Am I crazy?
Yeah. That's the only thing that dude ever did, I'm pretty sure. I mean, I'm sure he did other stuff, but like, you know.
I did find out another random fact about that song.
Did you?
I did my IMDb trivia research, but.
Lay it on me, sister.
The guy that, I don't know, do you know his name? The guy that wrote the song? I forget.
Ray Parker Jr.
Oh, Ray Parker Jr. Supposedly he was, it took him 2 days trying to figure out a jingle, like a song for the movie.
Yeah,
right. And he was up till like 4 a.m. one night, and a like a plumbing commercial came on. And it said, oh, it said something along the lines that made him think of Who You Gonna Call. And that, that helped him come up with the whole song. And and also the Ghostbusters, that part was inspired by like his little kid, Ray Parker Jr.'s kid, getting excited and just saying Ghostbusters like out loud, kind of just yelling it, I think.
Ray Parker Jr. Jr.
Yes, the Jr. Jr.
Okay.
But anyways, boom, she turns a corner, big ghosts, bright lights. We don't see the ghost yet, but she gets shocked by a ghost, and then the boom, the title card comes in, and the famous
theme song.
Do you see the ghost?
Yeah.
We see the ghost. I fucked up. And
oh, wait, you're right.
I don't think you do yet, because I thought you did.
Yeah, you're right. You see her face, and like the wind blow up back. Right.
And I think from there it goes to the college, and we're with Bill Murray, right?
Yeah, and the dean or whatever they call the head of a college or whatever. He's like, "Yeah, we're not gonna do this anymore because it's just a bunch of hokey bullshit."
Yeah,
and you know, Bill Murray's trying to prove his point, but he knows the dude's right. So
doesn't Bill Murray, he's like, you basically see his whole thing is like, he's like, it's like he's got these cards that have,
he's trying to prove mental telepathy, where he holds up the card.
Oh yeah, and he's like, got the symbol, like confirming all the hot girl stuff.
That's
very wrong. Yeah,
he keeps shocking that dude.
Yeah, he's tricking the dude,
man,
into thinking like the girl's actually reading his mind or whatever. She's not at all. He's like, oh, you guessed it correct, you know, can you see through the cards? He's just like,
he's trying to fuck her.
He's legitimately trying to have sex with her. And he keeps torturing the guy for no reason. Just shocking
the best line is after he gets shocked the last time, like, I mean, it's consistent shocking. You know, like electrocuting the shit out of this dude, and then the dude goes, this isn't worth the $5.
Yeah.
That's all he can say.
$5.
Oh, yeah. Oh, it's so good.
And it's funny because somehow his whole scheme that he's doing with this girl actually works, and she's swooned over by Bill Murray. And they set up like a date, but it never happens. In the movie, it never happens.
He goes, how about I pick you, or like something along the lines of, how about I pick you up at your place, say, and she goes, 9 o'clock. And he goes, I was just about to say 9 o'clock.
Yeah, that is good.
So good.
And then I think Dan Aykroyd walks in. Dan Aykroyd plays another guy that is also a parapsychologist. Is that how you say it? Parapsychologist. And they're all buddies at this, and they all do the same shit at the school. And Dan Aykroyd's kind of more serious about the shit. He's kind of more, I feel like, more of a scholar when it comes to this parapsychology, right?
He takes it seriously.
And he comes in and he's like, oh shit, that something actually went down at the library, right? Isn't that what he kind of comes in? And the whole time Bill Murray's like, dude, not right now.
<He's> like, yeah.
Even though this is like his life's work, he's like, dude, I've got a date, like,
right,
you know, he's kind of using it in a way to, like, you know, just get laid and shit.
Yeah.
And this is another reason why I was telling Whitley, this is a boy movie. This is very much
for
boys.
For sure.
Because she's like, maybe not their favorite movie. Because it's mostly just boys having fun.
There's another joke in there that did not age well at all. But I'll explain it as we go further.
Eventually, Dan Aykroyd talks Bill Murray into just like getting his head out of his ass, and they go to the library. And the lady that is spooked in the very beginning, the one that turns the corner and sees the ghost, she's just laid out like, holy fuck, what just happened? And they're surrounding her, and Bill Murray, some of the best lines in the movie, I feel like.
Dude, I think I know what you're about to say, but yeah.
Yeah, he walks up and I think the first question he asks is if anyone in her family is schizophrenic.
Yeah.
And what'd she say? Her uncle thinks that
he's somebody.
Saint something, man. Right?
Yeah. Oh gosh.
Which I think I looked up, and it's actually has a reference to library shit. It's like a they were like making a reference to
Okay.
Whitley's pulling a Jamie Joe Rogan style, and she's Googling things for us. Jamie Kennedy experience.
But the other question says,
"Oh yeah, are you menstruating?" That's the last one.
Are you menstruating? And she's like 87 years old.
And then the guy walks up, and Joey, one of Joey's favorite.
What does that have to do with anything?
Yeah.
Oh, so good.
Did you say back off,
man? I'm a scientist.
Yeah. That's probably one of them.
Saint Jerome.
Saint Jerome. Yeah.
So I think Saint Jerome is a priest, I guess, but a Horoni.
He's hot.
He's not hot. He's half.
I think he's pretty hot.
Okay. Anyways.
Jerome. Also known as Jerome of Stridon, is a Christian priest, confessor, theologian, and historian. He's commonly known as Saint Jerome. Was born.
Anyway, so the whole thing is they're basically, because Bill Murray's really not, he doesn't really believe in ghosts, I don't think, at all. Dan Aykroyd is more on the side. Dr. Raymond Stantz, So Dr. Stantz, he's like, he actually believes in ghosts.
So Dr. Stantz.
I know, this is all going to be weird. But Bill Murray is basically asking if she's like sane, because he doesn't really believe in ghosts.
Right.
And so eventually Harold Ramis, they like bump into Harold Ramis, which is their like third member of the Ghostbusters.
Right.
And he's like, he's also very actual, like very serious. He's like using
he's a legit scientist.
Yeah. And his character's name is Egon. Is that how you say Egon?
Egon Spangler.
Spangler. And he's actually listening to like a random table with like a microphone. And Bill Murray walks up and like drops a book and scares the shit out of him for a second. And they all join up and they go to look for the ghost that supposedly is haunting this library. And they go down there and they start seeing the slime, which is supposed to be ectoplasm. But yeah, maybe you can take it over from there. Yeah.
Well, so a couple of things. So like there's the ectoplasm, and they're walking down the corridor, and there's the file cabinets, like the little file cabinets are all jetted out in different areas or whatever. And they're covered in slime, all this other stuff. Crap on his hands, and he's got you know, all this other stuff. But as they're going, a bookshelf falls down behind them. That actually wasn't planned. Bookshelf it was a prop, so it just fell because they
hard.
Yeah, that's the whole thing. And then like their reaction of like all looking at each other like what the fuck just happened was literally them just like what the fuck just happened, because I'm pretty sure where they filmed, I mean, they made, you know, an area look like the basement of a library, and
the public library,
right? I think I can't remember if it's this place or if it's another scene. They used a place that was actually like supposed to be haunted or supposedly haunted.
Oh, yeah.
And so that prop falling down right behind them and nearly crushing them and everything, that was their genuine reaction to it.
You know what? You know what? You're right. I read on IMDb, it's another thing later in the movie. It's a place.
Okay.
It's legitimately haunted, and some weird shit actually happened. Some like poltergeist level shit happened.
Okay.
And it's kind of crazy. And it's funny because they all fell for it too. Like all the actors were creeped out by what happened.
Yeah.
So it's kind of interesting. But it's funny when people do movies about Oh, I mean, I'm saying this, but Poltergeist is really the only other one I can think of.
Well, there's a couple of ones, but I know where you're getting at.
Yeah. Like The Omen, we were talking about that. And all these like crazy things that happened. Like so many people died that were part of making that film.
Oh, scary. I remember like
the
it's like, is it just a coincidence?
Yeah. There's a lot of like actual deaths that occurred like right after the filming of those. Yeah, so they... Oh, the bookshelf falls, and it's really funny because Bill... I suppose that's another thing. I don't know if you probably didn't know this, but I was reading that most of the movie is, like, ad-libbed. It's, like...
Almost every bit of Bill Murray is ad-libbed.
Off the top. It's, like, off the script.
Yeah.
Which the whole... I'm going to be going back and forth, but the script in general was, like, multiple things before it became what it was.
Yes.
For Ghostbusters.
Right.
Well, it's just kind of crazy.
What else was it?
I don't know if I want to say it yet, just because I don't want to get too far off the path. But I think originally what it was going to be, Dan Aykroyd wanted it to be a futuristic world where Ghostbusters were almost like you call the ambulance, and there was multiple Ghostbusters. And then they said the budget for that would be crazy because they'd have to make like a futuristic world to like set the movie in.
Yeah.
So Harold Ramis actually...
was way darker too, I think.
Yeah,
it was actually like the ghosts were actually supposed to be like scary.
Yeah, I think they did some test screenings and children. They noticed that children actually really liked the movie. They like it was more like their world, and they cut out a lot of like sexual innuendos or whatever. But there's still innuendos. I can't say that word. Endodendos. Anyways, back to the movie. So the bookshelf falls and Bill Murray makes a joke about like, oh, this that never happened to you before, because he's just very like in shock. And they turn the corner and it's a legitimate ghost. It's like this old floating phantom
reading a book. Yeah.
Yeah. And it just like turns and looks at them, which the effects of this movie are fucking actually pretty cool. They're like really good.
Yeah. It's like a mix of practical and digital effects.
Yeah.
Like, it was that sweet spot in the 80s where like, you know,
they were actually
transition into CGI kind of stuff, but
yeah, and they turn and they don't really know what to do because they've never actually encountered a ghost, even though they are like, oh, we're gonna be the ghost guys, you know, the Ghostbusters. But they turn the corner and they and then they like regroup because Bill Murray pulls them aside. And he's like, what the fuck are we doing? Like, how are we gonna deal with this? And
he tries talking to her.
Yeah.
I can't remember exactly what he says. Like, hello, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And she like, turns to
One of the best lines he says, and I can't think of it. He says something about where are you from exactly, or something like, I forget what he says. What does he say?
Oh man,
I forget. But the way he says it's hilarious. But they meet up, they group up again, and Bill's like, "Hey, we gotta be serious." And then Dan Aykroyd's whatever, he has the big plan, right?
Yeah, he goes, okay, I've got it. I know exactly what to do.
Yeah,
and then
they
go. And they're like sitting there, and then all he says is, okay, one, two, get her! And then they jump at it. The ghost, and then, like, the ghost jumps at them, like, freaks them out, they run out, blah, blah. But afterwards, Bill Murray's just like, get her.
Get her, yeah.
He's like, that was your plan, get her.
That was, and then it's funny because they're all still, like, even though they like ran out screaming, they're all still pretty just psyched because they're like, oh, we fucking made contact with a ghost.
Right.
Like,
right.
We're going to be like the next hot shit, you know? Yeah. Oh, Whitley's got the scene pulled up here. We can, pop up a volume. Yeah. Where are you from originally? That's what
Yeah.
Where are you from?
Oh, man.
Originally. That was one of them.
Where are you from?
Yeah.
The comedic pause. So
And Dan Aykroyd and Harold Ramis, they're just like snapping pictures. Yeah, so they run out screaming, but they're all excited and they're still like, oh, even though we left, we know that there's ghosts and we can fucking actually be Ghostbusters.
Yes. This is actually something we can do to make money.
I think this is what is this when they get kind of kicked off the college campus? I think at this point. Or is it before this? I can't remember. If I can't remember if it's before that or not.
I think you're right. I think it's after that.
Because
they're jazzed about it, and then it's like raining on their parade a little bit.
Yeah, and then they're just like outside on the campus, like drinking whiskey together. And like, they're like, that's another of my favorite parts is when they're talking about like, oh, well, we got it, man. We just need to get our own new spot, you know. Yeah. I'm paraphrasing like what they're actually saying, but they, and Dan Aykroyd says something about like, how are we going to get the money for this? And Bill Murray just like takes a sip of whiskey. He's like, I don't know. And he takes like another drink. He's like, I don't know. It's like, you think he's going to like, actually going to, after one drink, you think he's going to come back and be like, I have the genius plan, because he's kind of like nodding his head. Like, I don't know, but I don't know.
I don't know.
But,
oh man. Then he sells Dan Aykroyd's character sells, I can't remember if he sold like his childhood farm or something
It's like his childhood home or something.
Yeah. To buy to get the money to buy somewhere for them to go. And they're scouting places, and it's the New York Fire Department, which is actually the inside of it is the LA Fire Department. So,
oh, wow. That's
you ever cool. go in there. Yeah. But that's one of my favorite scenes because like they're walking through it and it's completely just shit. It's dilapidated. Everything's falling apart. And like Egon or Harold Ramis and Bill Murray are just like, what the fuck are we getting into?
Yeah.
And you see Dan Aykroyd slide down the fireman pole. Yeah. He goes, oh, I love it. He's like, this is great. He goes, we should stay here like tonight.
Like, yeah, it's like a little kid.
Like a little kid moving into a new house.
Test it out.
Test it out. Yeah.
There's literally like cobwebs and like broken shit all around him.
Right.
And Harold Ramis, right before that, is like literally going down a list of everything that's wrong with him.
He's trying to get a better deal.
And then,
you know, Dan Aykroyd's character is like,
he's so giddy with excitement about the place.
it's like a 5-year-old. It's great.
So then I don't think they get their first call yet. They get kind of set up very quickly in the movie. There's like some holes.
There's no like this. I was like, it's ripe for an 80s like montage.
Yeah.
Of like, you know, getting everything in like high speed.
Yeah.
None of that. They just have
a
setup.
That's my bone to pick with this movie. I love everything about it, but it would be, and I'm sure it's something they wanted to do. Maybe they just didn't have time or money, but I wish there were more scenes like that, because it kind of jumps. Yeah. Like, they get the busted up car, and Bill Murray's like, you can't park that here, because he just thinks it's like some like bum like parking the car.
And it's like spray painted black. Yeah.
And it just, you see one scene of Dan Aykroyd like leaning into the engine, but then randomly it's like suited up.
Polished. Yeah.
Wish there were more scenes?
I wish there were more scenes where it's like, oh, what color should we paint it? Or like, oh, I don't know. What are we going to do about this car? Like, there's some kind of like, so it's not just randomly like, oh, because remember we were like.
I just wanted the whole film to be them just building the car.
Yeah, that's my part. That's my favorite film.
Yeah.
No, but.
I like when movies are a little snappier and they get to it. Like, but all the car was black. Like, why do you need to like be like.
Like, for instance, here's
go to the DMV.
No. No, but like, you can do it in clever ways. Like, for instance, I don't know why this is the second time we've referenced School for Rock, but I think it's just because it's a good movie. But in for instance, like School of Rock, how they get the band together, how they get, then they kind of just show you the process, even though it's like quick, you're still like,
they like put it to music and they just like imply.
Yeah.
Like,
and you really appreciate it when they actually play music together, because you're like, oh yeah, because remember when they were all together and they'd have the guy play the keyboard and then they'd have the.
But I feel like
there could have been some scenes
in together.
I know, but okay, here's the problem. On their first trip, this is my thing with Ghostbusters. I love them. I love it. But the first time they go,
on Ghostbusters. That's great.
They have their gear, but they're just kind of in street clothes, I think, right? They just kind of like show up to the place, the library. Probably because they weren't expecting it to be real.
Yeah. They have their suits on.
Oh, they do have their suits. Okay.
Yep.
That's what threw me off. In the part when they actually get the call, the first call, their secretary freaks out because they hired the secretary. They hired the secretary and she just sits around. And I think her and
Ghostbusters, what do you want?
And Harold Ramis is, they're, I guess, boinking, and they never really go that much deeper into it, but
yes,
He's like under her desk, and they never really explain that.
Yep.
But
actually, in the new Ghostbusters that came out, that all put together a little bit. Which I didn't like the new Ghostbusters that a whole lot. I mean, it was good, but it was
not like the original. But yeah, they finally get the secretary freaks out. She's like, "We've got one," and it's the hotel. They show up. Sorry, I might be getting this wrong. Sigourney Weaver doesn't show up yet, right?
No.
Hotel first.
Yep.
Hotel first, because that's how they get their kind of like their call to fame.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
They show up
right
at the hotel, and they show up and they do the fucking whole thing. They slide down the fire pole. They put on their suits. They get in the car, which is now suited up, and it's white, which I found out why they painted it white is because it stuck out better. They wanted to paint it black, but you wouldn't be able to see it at night in the film.
Right, right. And most of the scenes with the car in it are at night, though.
So. And it's like a ghost.
And it's like a ghost. That does make sense for it to be white.
Yeah, yeah.
So they drive up to the big New York hotel. Oh, the Sedgwick Hotel.
Sedgwick.
The hotel manager tells them that they are having problems with a resident ghost. Following a successful test of the equipment, they split up to search. Oh, yeah. This says following a successful test of the equipment. That is not a successful test of their equipment. What happens is they go up the elevator. And before they even do this, they're in the hotel. Another great line in the movie. It's a very Bill Murray thing. But as soon as they walk in, Bill Murray goes, "Anybody see a ghost around here?" Like, just right.
Just blatant. They're trying to, the hotel's trying to keep it hush-hush.
Yeah, you know? And they get up to the elevator, and there's, like, some old, like, guy standing next to the elevator, and he's like, "Who are you?" Because they're all in their suits. Oh, we're just pest control. And they're like, "Must be some pest or something." And it's like, "Cockroach, I'll eat your head off," or something is what they
bite
say.
"Bite your freaking head off."
Yeah, bite your freaking head off. And
then with that old man, like, as they're getting into the elevator, I can't remember if it's Ray or Egon, but they have the PKE meter. They like wave it over the old man.
They go up, and as soon as they get off the elevator, because they know they're on the floor that the ghost is on.
In the elevator. Dan Aykroyd turns on his proton pack, and they're all like in the elevator. You just see Bill Murray and Harold Ramis. Because it like makes this like nuclear like buzzing noise.
They're like up in the elevator.
They
finally get up, and they know that the things they're using are dangerous. They're like ridiculous machines. They're proton packs. And as soon as they get off the elevator, they see something and they blast it, and it's like
immediately.
The first time they've ever even used, I think, their proton packs.
Yeah.
And it's like this super, which so badass. The beams that come out of the proton pack, like the sound design and like the look of those are so cool.
Yes.
It's almost like rotoscoped. It almost looks like drawn over.
Right.
It's like really cool pink and purple. And
dude, honest to God, that's like one of my favorite things about the movie. Just the colors they used and everything. It just looks so cool.
Yeah. They blast a maid. A maid's cleaning cart. They fucking like burn the shit out of it. Do they mention anything about crossing streams before that one, or is that later in the movie?
That's later. Yeah,
it was after they had already used it, and it was like, oh, thanks.
So it was like an afterthought. Oh wait, yeah. Actually, by the way, you could completely ruin the universe if you cross streams.
Yeah.
They eventually find the chubby. Oh, Bill Murray does. They split up. Right. Bill Murray, Harold Ramis, and I keep calling them by their actors' names because their other names I can't remember. Venkman and Spengler.
Was
it Stance?
Yes.
They all split up to just try to find the ghost faster, and Bill Murray ends up finding him on his own. It's like this chubby green ghost, which everybody knows if you know Ghostbusters. Which supposedly the chubby green ghost, the way he is and his like mannerisms and the way he is supposed to be a reference to John Belushi.
Yes.
Yeah, which is really cool. Yeah. If it's like Dan Aykroyd's buddy. Because, and,
Blues Brothers. Yeah, he was supposed to be Venkman, and he died before they started filming it. He
wrote the part. Man, that's crazy. So he was going to play Bill Murray's part. Was going to be John Blues.
Yeah. And you can kind of see it in a couple things, but like the whole Slimer, the Green Ghost, his whole thing is it's supposed to be John Belushi in Animal House. So like,
it's like stuffing food in his mouth.
And the part where he chugs the bottle of liquor and like all that thing. It's actually like there's a part in Animal House where he's chugging a bottle of liquor, and if you play him like side by side, it's like the same duration of like holding it and
wow,
pretty cool.
Wonder if they like animated around that, like
I don't know, that could be something
they could use as a model. So Bill Murray basically gets on the walkie talkie and is like, I'm looking at the ghost that they called us for. He gets the ghost charges him. The right. Slime and
goes through the wall. Yeah.
It slimes him, right? He gets slimed.
I got slimed.
And then do they catch him this time? Yeah, they do, don't they? Yeah, because
they totally destroy the dining hall.
That's when they talk about crossing streams.
That was even after. They went full blown, like I'm pretty sure they like did all their thing, got the ghost, and then like I think it was like the next time or right after that, that's when they talked about the streams.
Okay, so even after they...
Right?
The boys make their first bust, is what I'm reading.
During this is, like, they're all shooting at Slimer, and they're going everywhere.
Yeah.
And they get close to each other, and Ray yells, "Don't cross the streams."
Okay, yeah.
And then I think later in the movie, they find out that they should do that.
Yeah. It becomes an important part of the movie is them crossing streams, which is another boy reference. I'm pretty sure. I feel like it's a boy reference to pissing. And
yeah, absolutely.
So
absolutely.
Another thing, at least taken out of this, just less girl stuff.
There's a lot.
It's a sexist film. It's completely against women.
It's why they made it.
And then they had to go
and make one with all women.
Yeah, they had to even it out.
That's right.
So they catch the ghost. They
catch Slimer. Yeah, and then the next day,
Slimer was my nickname in high school.
Okay, get the girl.
Mine too. That's why I have to get circumcised again.
Oh my god, Slimer. It's
really hard to clean, you know?
They get the ghost in their
magma.
They suck it into this little, what do you call it? Their little box.
It's a ghost trap.
And they walk out, and it's really clever is what they do, is they walk out and they're like, "Oh, we got your ghost." And they basically destroy the hotel in certain parts.
Yeah.
They like blast with their guns, their proton packs, and they like...
We came, we saw, we kicked its ass.
Yeah. And they walk out, and I think Bill Murray's holding it, and the hotel manager is like, what is it? What did you get it? And he's like, "Yeah, well, we got it. It's right here." And it's like the
class
smoking...
vaporous phantasm, and a nasty one at that, yeah.
Yeah, and then the hotel guy's like, then they're like, "Well, with all the..." I forget, they add up some kind of summary of...
They just keep making the bullshit things that they did.
They're like, $4,000.
Yeah, $4,000.
Like, forget it.
Oh, plus $1,000.
Yes, but when they're doing that, though, if you watch the, like, Bill Murray's trying to come up with a number, and you see Harold Ramis go...
Like four.
Yeah. And then he goes,
like one for 1,000.
Yeah.
That's hilarious. So that's
where they gain their notoriety, and they get, you know, they get the commercial and all that kind of stuff.
What's good about that too is that the guy isn't going to accept it. He's like, "I will never pay that." And then they're like, "Oh, we'll just put it back then."
We can just put it back.
Which is so clever, because it's like, obviously, no, I'm like, who else is going to do it? Who else is going to get the ghost?
Take the chance.
Yeah, no.
You know, like if they actually did.
It's so perfect, because you're like, yeah, if you put anyone in that position, they're like, "Fuck no, I'm not going to take the ghost back and not know how to get it out again," you know.
It's good business.
You
know, you can learn something.
So yeah, they're basically the Beatles now. They're
so this is like the montage of them doing
puss. They're fucking ghosts.
Yeah, they are. They literally are fucking
literally
ghosts.
Yep.
Clubs full of succubi. What?
Oh, sorry. I cut you off.
No. I was just gonna say that's the montage where it's like showing all the different ghosts. Larry King, that part.
Yeah.
They're on like Time magazine. And then they get their commercial, which is where Sigourney Weaver comes in. Or Dana.
Yeah.
I say I loved seeing Larry King
young
yes. and just smoking a cigarette and his I was like, man.
I know, to be Larry King, what a chill job. I mean, not really. I mean, just imagine what we're doing, but times 5,000.
Lived like such a life. It was just wild.
Yeah, Larry King is one of my favorites.
They actually they were filming a scene like close to where he does his show, and they like ran into him, and he wanted to be in it.
That's hilarious. Like, of course.
They're like, yeah, we're gonna let Larry King. You
know? Yeah, that's hilarious. Yeah, so. They pop off. So wait, here's the question.
Yeah.
They see, okay, that's true. Okay, you're right. Sigourney Weaver sees their ad on the TV and kind of brushes it off like, huh, goofballs. And then she comes back to her apartment with groceries. She sits her groceries on the table and her eggs pop out. They start sizzling.
They're like cooking. Yeah.
And they pop out of the carton, which is a crazy practical effect. I don't know how they did it.
Yeah, yeah.
And they must have
turned it into like a stove underneath the like the what you call it, the countertop,
like the tile.
Yeah, didn't it like actually? It started cooking on the
actually was, and it was legitimately cooking the eggs. It wasn't like a big thing because they were even saw the bubbling of the eggs.
Yeah, yeah. If
I
you actually
say,
like.
I really loved Sigourney Weaver's apartment. I love the couch and the chairs. Yeah. I couldn't stop thinking about them. I'm still thinking about them. I think they're so great. They're like so pink. They're like the perfect
pink. She had a great view of the city too.
Yeah, she had such cool like window decor.
Which the view of the city, I'm pretty sure was green screen.
Yeah, I mean, like, I just want to know how like a orchestra person, that's what she was in the movie. How she could afford a high-rise apartment like that.
I know. And supposedly she's like, well, here's the thing. There's a scene in the movie where Bill Murray, which we'll get into later.
Oh, with that guy?
Yeah, and she says to Bill Murray, because Bill Murray's like, who's that schmuck or whatever? Mm-hmm. She's like, oh, well, he happens to be like one of the best musicians in the world. So I think maybe she is like a kind of, like, they don't really say it, but I think high maybe up. She is like a high-up, like, cellist.
Right.
Is that how you say it?
Right.
Cellist?
I don't know what...
I think she was a cellist, supposedly. But,
in that same scene, though, where she sets her groceries down and the eggs start, you know, going nuts. If you look in the background with her groceries, there's a bag of Stay Puft marshmallows.
Yeah, which isn't a real product.
No. Well.
Oh, here we go. No. See, that's what I'm talking about.
What's in there?
Joey, so for listeners, Joey just held up what looks like a Stay Puft.
Oh, yeah. I keep forgetting. Yeah,
yeah. I know. The audio portion. What is it? This is a Stay Puft.
If I can find something. Hold on.
Can you eat this?
Maybe. No, you can't.
I can't eat it.
Oh, is that?
What is? Is it just goo?
It's slime.
Oh, it's slime?
Aubrey wanted it because Ghostbusters is one of her favorite. Cool. It's more like the shaving cream at the end of the movie.
Yeah, there's a thing. I wondered that too. Looked it up. Yeah. It
smells so bad though.
It looked like shaving cream.
It was shaving cream. And it was menthol. So supposedly there was some people that had allergic reactions to it. And there was much of it. But Sigourney Weaver, she has the egg phenomena happen. Her eggs start cooking on her counter out of nowhere. And then she hears a demonic growl. And she looks and it's coming from her refrigerator. She walks over, opens the refrigerator, and this is one of the most badass scenes in the movie. She opens the refrigerator and it's a whole fucking other like universe inside of her refrigerator.
That's what your refrigerator is like sometimes.
My refrigerator looks very similar. I need to call the Ghostbusters.
clean it out.
Here's another little trivia about that. So real life, Sigourney Weaver had a fire in her apartment. I think not very much longer after the film was made, and the fire department showed up real life and they put the fire out and they noticed who she was and they looked at her refrigerator and said, better call Ghostbusters.
No like, way.
Because they were just fans of Ghostbusters. And they're
oh my God. Up. And she's just like, shut the fuck up. My house just burned.
Yeah. So immediately she's like, okay, ghost shit's real. Because that yeah. shit happens in her apartment.
And yeah, she gets pulled into her thing, right? Or no?
Oh,
or she
signs it not. Not yet.
Not yet. You're right. You're right. That's you're true. Right. You're
that
right.
was like when the, she was going to go on a date with Bill Murray finally, and then she got yes. sucked in and could never go.
Yeah, yes. because, okay, well, let's back it up.
Bag it up. Yeah, yeah.
Bag it up. So she, the goofy Ghostbuster commercial ain't so goofy anymore. And so right. she shows up to the Ghostbusters headquarters. And
Bill Murray sees her and is immediately
I'm all fucked up. No. Oh no, I feel like we fucked up somewhere, because when she shows up, the Ghostbusters need shit to do.
Yeah, no, they're like,
she had already we fucked up the timeline. She shows up before their hotel thing. Yeah,
you're right.
We fucked up. Sorry guys, sorry ghost heads.
I'm ghost a ghost head and I fucked it up.
Sorry ghost heads.
It is weird.
Busted.
Because, so busted. What really happens is...
So what really happens is...
Before the hotel thing, their big bust, they go to Sigourney Weaver's because she has the whole phenomenon happen with her kitchen.
Yeah.
She shows up to the Ghostbusters and they're fucking begging for someone to give them a case. Right. Bill Murray like jumps over his like thing at his desk and like, oh yeah, we're the Ghostbusters, and he's can't wait. And she's like, he's definitely like flirting with her. He's like, thinks
just
she's
trying to get it. Yeah,
he's just trying to get laid. He does not care about ghosts still. And right. she is very like, they're like the first person they've actually talked to that's like, oh yeah, I legitimately am dealing with a ghost.
Yeah, visibly distraught.
Harold Ramis and Dan Aykroyd are both like, oh yeah, this sounds legitimate. Let's check it out. Let's send Bill Murray over. Check out her apartment, and he's like, and Bill Murray says something funny like, yeah, I'm gonna go check her out, and like and fucks
yeah,
up
yeah.
and she's immediately like creeped out by him, and he shows up and he's almost got like a pest control like weird thing, and
they basically set up like a whole bunch of different props, and they were like, hey, you can just pick one, whatever one you think, and they were filming
oh really
yeah he just picked that and just started doing weird shit with it.
That's so he's
one of my okay so just because of this scene, when he gets to her apartment,
mm-hmm.
every time I pass a piano now,
he
like just taps the like top two notes back and forth. He goes, I hate it when I do that.
Yeah,
like he's supposed like to be. Yeah,
I feel like you've done that in front of me, and I was just like, have. What the fuck? And then like laughed because it was so random. And yes. I did not know that's what's...
So many things came from this movie that happened like that.
He makes a lot of... Wilmer makes a lot of sexual jokes while he's there and creeps her out. She says something. He's like going into her bedroom and she's like, oh, nothing happened in there. And he goes, that's a crime. Oh yeah, what a crime.
Yeah.
Like, and then says something about you live alone or something.
Yeah, yeah. Then when she's talking about that, where he asks like, or he goes, is this where it happened? You know, the refrigerator.
Yeah.
And he comes and he goes, oh my God. She goes, oh, yeah. What? He goes, look at all the junk food.
Yeah. It's like Coca-Cola and random shit.
Yeah.
And she's pissed off because basically she's not seen any ghost activity. They go back home, whatever. He basically gets shooed off by her because he gets a little creepy. He says something about he loves her. She's the love of his life.
Yeah, yeah.
And tries to get a kiss from her as he leaves. And Rick Moranis sees this happen too, by the way. Honey, I Shrunk the Kids. Rick Moranis.
In this movie, good Lord. Honest to God, he's probably... It's so hard to say who my actual favorite character is.
Wow. You would say Rick Moranis might be one of your favorites.
Dude, Louis Tully is... It's just so funny. It's like... So, one, Rick Moranis was not supposed to be that person. That was supposed to be John Candy.
Which is, real quick, so for people, it's the neighbor of Sigourney Weaver. He's
the
like
neighbor
the
of
nerdy...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Anyways.
It was supposed to be John Candy. And when John Candy came in to read for it, he wanted to change the character to be a big German guy with two miniature schnauzers. And they were like, no, we can't pull that off. And so he's like, well, you know, I got something else going on. I think he did like Planes, Trains, and Automobiles that year. So
oh, wow.
He wound up being okay. So
that's a good one.
Lewis Tully, though, freaking, so I think he's an insurance salesman or like an insurance adjuster or something like that.
All he fucking talks about.
And he's a swinger. That's like a swingers party that he throws at his house. But well, I guess it ties into something later. But there's a reason. Like, so he goes up to her door. She shuts the door, and like he's like, oh, okay. Well, good talking to you. He goes back to his house, and then his door is locked. He locked himself out of his apartment.
Yeah.
And then that happens three times in this movie. He locked himself out of his own goddamn apartment. Anyway, yes. So there we are.
Oh yeah.
Setting it up for later because there's something else that goes with that. So
yeah. So just a reminder that Rick Moranis he ends up being a very big part of this movie. And he kind of just seems like a random character throughout because you just kind of see him. And Whitley's looking up John Candy's death. Heart attack, if anyone wondered.
But this photo is hilarious.
Oh my God.
John Candy. God, I love
it. I have to just save this and we can put it. That's irrelevant, I guess.
Anyways, I don't want to get too
Okay, I'm going to go off on a side tangent now while we're talking about John Candy because there are a lot of people that were supposed to be in this movie that didn't wind up being in this movie. So,
oh wow,
a good segue.
There we go.
Segue.
So John Candy was supposed to be Lewis Tully or the neighbor. We already talked about
that's great.
John Belushi. Supposed to be Peter Venkman or Bill Murray's character. Also for that role was Chevy Chase, and Chevy Chase didn't want it. She's still
looking at John
Candy.
It's like a medical picture of what a heart attack is.
Share it with them on Discord.
It's not right.
Just let him play. Wait, no. Well, you gotta do it now.
Funny. Not here. I have to show him.
It's like what they would show you.
You can see it's not funny. Like I think you should just send
it. Yeah, just send it to me. Send it to me, and then you can put it up in the thing.
No, no, you can see.
No, but he can't. He really needs to zoom in on it.
Yeah, you're a tiny. Oh, okay. Wait. No. Do it again. We can edit this. Let's see.
It's just supposed to be like what a heart attack is, and it's just showing this guy, and he's like grabbing. It.
I don't really know windbreaker. Why. Really thinks this is. Comedy, but
that's funny. Ghostbusters.
Yeah.
Sorry. Okay.
Anyways, you're on. Oh, so yeah, John Candy was supposed to be Rick Moranis' character.
Yeah, Lewis Tully. John Belushi was supposed to be Peter Venkman. Chevy Chase was supposed to be Peter Venkman, but he didn't want to do it because he was doing
all his vacation shit, probably.
Vacation stuff. Yeah. Then Michael Keaton. Supposed to be.
Thank God that didn't happen. I cannot imagine him in Ghostbusters.
Yeah. Well, he was supposed to be Peter Venkman, but he's also supposed to be Egon Spengler, like the Harold character.
Yeah.
Which would not have worked at all. No. And then Ernie Hudson, Winston, the African American Ghostbuster that shows up halfway through the movie.
Well, there's some trivia on that one too.
Supposed to be Eddie Murphy, and then Eddie Murphy wound up doing Beverly Hills Cop that year.
Thank God he didn't do Ghostbusters and did Beverly Hills Cop because I love Beverly Hills Cop.
Yeah, there's a couple other people too. I can't remember them off the top of my head, but a lot of people were supposed to do different roles in this. And Ron Jeremy's in this movie as an extra in the background.
Oh my God!
The ghosts start like going nuts and like flying out everywhere. Ron Jeremy's in the background. He's got his dick out.
Random. So. Okay, so after we leave Sigourney Weaver's apartment and Bill Murray's shootout, then they get that hotel we talked about earlier. They get the hotel job and they become like the Beatles of Ghostbusting, which was never even a thing in the first place.
Ghostbusting?
They're busting. And what is it, the saying? I forget. They say something about busting. Then they get the thing and then... What's up? Oh, they're the Beatles, basically. And then they're doing all... And then the montage happens, and then, like, they're famous.
Right.
And now, where the fuck are we?
This is when they hire the fourth member.
Oh, then the fourth guy shows up, right?
Because they have so much work, they can't. Winston, yeah.
Winston shows up, which is like a script kind of a flub, I feel like, in the movie. I feel like Winston was supposed to be like this demolition expert from the Air Force.
Right.
Which was like Eddie Murphy.
It was supposed to be through the entire movie, I thought.
Yeah.
Initially,
I think
it was
so.
Like from like start to end. Yeah.
Yeah, it seems like they just sort of like inserted him. What?
We'll squish his part down way farther and not make it that important. Which is kind of awkward because he's the only black guy in Ghostbusters.
Is he also in the sequels?
Yes, he's in the sequel. But fun fact, the cartoon, the cartoon called The Real Ghostbusters, the character Winston, he went in to do the voice acting for that character, and they said it didn't sound enough like Winston, so they didn't hire him for it. He's like, dude, that's me. Like, it's a cartoon character of me.
Doesn't sound Winston.
Doesn't sound right. Yeah.
I feel like
it's like it was like a last minute thing almost.
I really think that like Eddie Murphy was really supposed to be in it up until like the like pound of the wire, and then he just dipped out because he got a better offer for.
Yeah, but why not just not include a fourth member? They like he wasn't even really needed because of they put him in there anyway.
Because I think it's so complicated with the script. So many things happen, and then you just like don't want one thing to get taken out because this will fuck
like
another thing up.
Yeah.
It's like stuff just keeps messing up the script if you take things out or put things in. I think that maybe that was what it is. Maybe I don't know.
But they basically wrote out. Like, if Eddie Murphy was supposed to be in there the whole time, then they obviously took out a bunch of stuff because that guy wasn't in there the whole time.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, I feel like they didn't think that he would be as funny as Eddie Murphy.
Yeah.
Which is probably true, but...
I think it would have been pretty awesome, though, if Eddie Murphy was in it,
dude,
sadly.
It probably would have been fucking great.
It would be kind of cool to see him alongside Dan Aykroyd and everybody.
Yeah.
So one night, Dana Okay, so I think this is what we're coming up on. One night, Dana enters her apartment and is talking on the phone to her mother. After she hangs up, and it's like a very like whatever conversation. She's like, "Yeah, mom, everything's good." Blah blah blah. And after
on a date.
Yeah, she's like, going on a date. She got a date with Bill Murray because now he's hot shit.
He's just
talented. And after she hangs up, she gets grabbed by claws that burst out of her chair.
It comes out of
her chair.
The chair
gets her. It's actually very scary. It's very poltergeisty, which makes sense that the guy that did the effects for Poltergeist, same guy.
Oh, really?
Which I found out.
Really?
Yeah, and all kinds of shit. Star Wars, Indiana Jones, big time shit.
I did enjoy like the...
actual practical stuff.
Dang, these are pretty good and like fun.
Oh, and like claymation shit.
Yeah, the claymation I did enjoy that with the dog.
It's so janky but good. Yeah, like the dog shit.
Oh,
it's so like
the dogs. Yes, they're so good.
So she is okay. That's another thing we didn't mention. The fridge demon.
Yeah.
Sigourney Weaver keeps telling everyone. It keeps mentioning Zool. It's like they're chanting Zool. It's like this god. So she is taken into the kitchen where she becomes possessed by Zool in this scene.
Yes.
So meanwhile, Rick Moranis' character, Rick Moranis, another resident of the apartment is he's hosting his swinger party for the fourth anniversary of him becoming an accountant. Good lord.
He can write it off. From work.
So he has all his clients in there, right? And he's like divulging like their really personal financial information as he's passing them to like everybody. They have Roth IRA set up.
By the way, that whole thing, improv.
Really?
I found out that all the shit he says is made up off the top of his head.
That's so good.
And it is a long shot too. They don't cut. So they just like keep
following on the table.
So it's just him just like saying shit, and it is really funny.
Do you have any Excedrin or extra strength Tylenol?
Gee, I think all I got is acetylsalicylic acid generic. See, I can get 600 tablets of that for the same price as 300 of a name brand. That makes good financial sense. Good advice. Hey, this is real smoked salmon from Nova Scotia, Canada, $24.95 a pound. It only cost me $14.12 after tax, though. I'm giving this whole thing as a promotional expense. That's why I invited clients instead of friends. You having a good time, Mark? How you doing? Why don't you have some of the brie? It's at room temperature. You think it's too warm in here for the brie?
It's hosting a party for the fourth anniversary of becoming an accountant. Wait, a dog. They hear like the demon sound again. Attacks and chases him out of the building, and
he goes to the door because he hears the dog, and he goes, "Okay, who brought the dog?"
Okay,
and then it's like, yeah, which Bin's is really horror though,
isn't it? Like the, a gargoyle, gargoyle,
gargoyles,
a gargoyle.
Yeah,
that soundbite.
Gargoyles. Yeah, we'll throw in right here is a dark-sided lady. We'll throw in real quick, dark-sided lady saying gargoyles.
I want these crew members leaving. Get these air sets off of me. I've had enough. Gargoyles, psychics, everything's ungodly. Dark-sided.
There we go. There, it'll be in the podcast.
But yeah, so like the whole thing is like the dogs are supposed to be like the
go with the guy. Whitley can't. She can't get enough of dark-sided lady.
I don't even know what you're talking about. I don't know.
Jesus warrior.
You're just like dark-sided lady, Jesus warrior.
Wilson did
Jesus warrior.
It was from Trading Spouses. You've never seen it. That like very large woman.
Yes.
And she's like,
yes.
Yes. Anyways.
Okay. That.
Anyways, Joey was on it. Joey was on it on the next plot point here.
We took them off. I was just saying the dogs. It's like a Sumerian god. Gozer is a Sumerian god. Okay,
that's the actual god. But so Zul is Zul like another
Zul
god?
And Vins Gortho or Vins Clortho. So Zul is what is the dog thing that possesses Sigourney Weaver, and Vins Clortho is the dog thing that possesses Rick Moranis' character. And they are the gatekeeper and the key master. Okay.
Yes. Yes.
And so like that, okay, that's where the whole thing with Rick Moranis comes into, is because just like a tiny little like nod, you know.
Yeah.
But they are the like the hellhounds for Gozer, which is the, you know, the god that shows up at the end of the film. But
they're kind of trying to create this like mass this just ultimate destruction demon god, right? Basically kind of what it's... And that's kind of like the whole... Okay, Willie's got kind of something on Zul here.
Like I was just reading, I thought maybe it was a real thing, but it was just created for the
movie. I thought so, too. I looked that up, too, because like it's based on a couple different things. Actually, so Gozer, right? Mm-hmm. The... what you call it? The... Amityville House, or the actual one of the
Gozer.
I'm letting you talk, Jay. Sorry.
No, you're good. I'm gonna need a second to remember what it was because it's so good.
So it says okay, yeah. So according to Dan Aykroyd, Gozer was based on several things: a Gozer Chevrolet dealership in upstate New York, and was a name related to a documented haunting in Enfield, England, which is Poltergeist was based
Poltergeist,
on.
Poltergeist, yes.
Poltergeist.
And Gozer, it like showed up in blood on the wall, I think. Like Gozer
something like that,
that's right.
She kept, whoever like was seeing these like poltergeists or whatever kept talking about Gozer and how Gozer was like, this like spirit, and I don't know, but kind of a cool callback to that. But also, it's also, hey, tie back to the very first thing. If you're reading the same article I was reading, a Gozer is also the surgeon that performs circumcisions in Judaism.
Oh, is that who's gonna circumcise you again?
Yes. Okay. There is no Dana, only Zul. That's what I call.
Okay. All right. I know where we're at. And Joey, I think I figured it out. So where we're at now, so Rick Moranis, he's become possessed. Peter makes a visit. Bill Murray's character, Venkman. He makes a visit to Dana's apartment. Sigourney Weaver's apartment.
Do you think it's Wankman?
No, because of V.
But wait, that's actually, Bill Murray. Yeah, but like if you're German, it's like Wankman. Okay. So like maybe, is that another guy joke? Like he's wanking it?
Yeah.
It is. Is that a wank?
It literally is.
I had a name, like the actual like Ghostbusters name badge that says Wankman on it.
Oh, man.
But it really is like a wank joke?
Oh, no, I don't think so. I don't know.
You were just probably. Like agreeing to it.
Oh, I thought he was too.
Maybe it is.
Like, oh, I'm so smart.
But yeah, Bill Murray shows up to her apartment and he quickly realizes that he as he's walking up to the apartment, there's like destruction because like the demon dog is like ravaged. Like he's like ran through the hotel hallways. And, but he like, cause he's such like a fucking doof. He kind of just walks up and, showing up for the date that they had arranged after he'd become like hot shit from Ghostbusting. He realizes that, oh yeah, she's changed radically, right? Dana opens the door. Wait, yeah, she opens the door once and she's like,
are you the key master?
She looks like she's like almost in like a weird old like perfume commercial. She's like very like, she's like her hair's like flowing in the wind. And she's like a siren or like a, she's like just like beckoning him in. Like, are you the key master? That's right. Yeah. And he's like, no. And then like, she shuts the door on him. And then he like does the whole thing again, and then he just says yes because like, the other answer. And right. He quickly realizes that she's possessed, and she's like really trying to bang him. She's like,
I'm really glad he didn't take advantage of her while she was possessed.
Yeah, that's the thing. This movie, it could have easily been a thing where he's like, okay, I'll just fuck the shit out of her while she's.
So you remember earlier where I said there's a really inappropriate joke?
Oh no,
that didn't age well. So when. After he's in there for a minute, after he's realized what's going on, and she's talking about Gozer and Keymaster and all this other stuff.
Yeah.
He calls Ray to tell him what's going on. Or either Ray or, you know, Harold Ramis' character.
Egon.
And they ask, like, you know, what is she, you know, is she, like, you know, freaking out or anything like that? He goes, oh, I've got her on about 500 cc's of Thorazine. Which it was meant as a joke, but like it just didn't age well.
So yes,
he says something too, like she's trying to get him to bang her, and he says, I don't know, it's already pretty crowded in there.
Oh no. And then he's basically trying to get to her. He's like, can I speak to, what's her name? Dana. I need to speak to Dana here. Because he knows that this is not her. And what, Willie, you took me off the page. I don't know what
I'm sorry, I was just looking at the history of Thorazine.
I need it as a reference. So yeah, he's rejecting her advances. Like, he's not going to bang her. And then she starts floating, which is really cool. They actually did physically make her lift up off the bed. It wasn't.
Oh, she didn't do that?
She actually...
She wasn't possessed?
She didn't actually float like that?
They made a cast
of her. You ruined my childhood, man. That was my favorite part.
They made a cast of her body, and then they, like...
Oh, so it wasn't even her?
No, it was. Yeah. I think that's something that's holding her body that's...
What's a cast? What do you mean?
Cast, like a mold. Like...
Why would they make a mold of her if she was in the...
Tanner, you're really fucking this up for
everybody. Well, I'm saying, like, if you make a cast of someone, it's like a fake
version
of them. They had, like, a pole or something that
looked
like that.
Yeah.
But her dress, like, was flowy, so it covered the pole to where you couldn't see it. Yeah.
Okay. Different cast.
Louis, Harold Ramis, similar. He's possessed by Vince Clortho. Gozer's Keymaster.
He is the Keymaster.
Bill Murray is not the Keymaster, but the goofy ass Harold Ramis, or not Harold Ramis, goddammit, Rick Moranis. And he's just running around the streets of New York. He harasses locals until finding a carriage horse and confusing it with the gate. I don't even remember that part.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. just his face in that scene too. He's just like staring at this horse gone like this. And the cop that's like horse on the guy, horse.
He's like, what the fuck are you doing? Yeah. Like, do you want to ride?
The whole
like,
movie, like that. Rick Moranis, while he's possessed, just seems like someone that took way too much acid.
He's like, yes. just lost. Yeah.
His eyes are like glowing, but he's just like, where am I? What is happening?
It's so funny because like this like completely like this hellhound demonic like crazy fucking entity is stuck inside of Rick Moranis. Like just like the most like unsuspecting person.
Yeah.
It's the best.
So eventually, man, I'm trying to get to the part because I know they get arrested because
there's another like subplot line where this guy who runs, I think he's like, he's trying to shut them down. And the containment thing for, this is why the whole thing at the very end happens, is because the containment thing that they keep all of their ghosts in is basically like faulty. When this guy's trying to open it up and he takes them, it goes to like the mayor of New York and
it's like an environmental hazard.
Right, yeah, right. And they show earlier in the movie how it's almost like they explain the ghost like trap mechanism, like almost like you're teaching a new factory worker how to use a machine. It's just like, you push the ghost in, you press the button, you pull the latch, you do this, and then your ghost is gone.
The light. Yeah.
And really, what's just, they're just building this. There's all these entities in this one thing.
yeah.
And they can't be released.
The guy winds up getting a court order to go to to open it up.
So wait, who is that guy? Who is the guy, the bad?
He's like that dude plays a lot of like that type of character too. And I can't remember like.
Is it the mayor? No, it's not the mayor.
No. I think he's like an EPA guy or something like that.
I'm trying to remember why he even gets frustrated with the Ghostbusters. I can't remember what.
He's just like someone looking for an issue.
He's just like a scum with a stick up his ass. I feel like there was something else.
Thought that was just like, he just kind of came out of nowhere.
But he shows up and he's like, let me see this. He's kind of like, he's kind of playing it off as he's just interested in the Ghostbuster stuff. But really what he wants to see is, where is this mechanism that holds all these entities? Like, I feel like he like doesn't really believe what's going on.
Yeah.
He's kind of like, this is some bullshit. These guys aren't, they're just,
I think he's like hustling. Just a very like, yeah, I think he's like,
by the book.
Oh, this is like not real, but
they're scamming people.
They're like doing, but they're like doing something that's like illegal, and like I can find them and like, you know, just cause an issue.
It's like if anything, if anyone gets very, they find gets anything lucrative going, there's going to be somebody that shows up being like, okay, wait a minute. Like, where's the bullshit at? You know, it's like that guy. And
you're paying taxes on this,
brother. And he goes down there, and like a cop is there. I forget. He could, because the permit. Like
two cops with him,
And they're all fighting about, and everyone's saying, the Ghostbusters are saying, don't fuck with that. You know,
what's he say? We're talking, he says, talking end time stuff, real wrath of God stuff is what he says.
Yeah. Like, and this is going to end the fucking world if you fuck with this.
Right.
But they do. They fuck with it.
That's okay, so you remember you were talking about the proton pack where they shoot the streams, like the color and the like the drawn thing. Same thing for when all of the ghosts get released.
Yeah.
And it's shooting all over New York and like all the different
cool.
Dude, okay. The song they play in that scene.
Yeah, what is
actually
that?
Pretty, I don't know what it is, but it's gangster. I don't know.
For a second, I thought it was David Bowie because it sounds very like Bowie-like.
There is a David Bowie reference in this movie, but
really? Not
quite there yet. So all of the ghosts get, you know, they're everywhere. There's the taxi driver, the burnt taxi driver. Yeah. You know, Slimer. You see Slimer running around. All this other stuff. So
he comes out of a hot dog. He comes out of a hot dog.
Yeah, he eats a hot dog cart. Ray So Ray is his job after there's a tiny scene that he mentions what he does. It's like he also runs an occult bookstore. So like versed in all of like the old, like, you know,
Dan Aykroyd,
legends
Dan Aykroyd.
And stuff like, yeah, Dan Aykroyd's character. And so he mentions that, which I found out, like Whitley was saying, I was trying to see if Gozer was real, you know. Mm-hmm. And so they kind of just tie it to like a Sumatran god, which isn't like true. And they tie to like the Tibetan Book of the Dead. And they say, you know, if the gatekeeper and the keymaster meet each other, then that's when Gozer will appear and it will either come in the form of whatever it wants. Yeah. And so what they have to do to stop it is to destroy Gozer, which is like the main thing.
Yeah.
So they have to get Rick Moranis' character to meet up with Sigourney Weaver's character.
Yeah.
Also, in the background of all of this, there's a lot of info put out at like one time, like right when this happens, like when he starts explaining all of this. So like the guy that built the apartment building that Dana is in. But yes, Ivo Shandor is this like a dude that was versed in the occult and all this other stuff and was really focused on getting making points to where they were basically spiritual satellite antennas to where it would like harness supernatural
like
power.
Nipples.
That's right. Those nipples.
Whitley won't take this shit serious.
I'm sorry.
But so that guy built the apartment building that Dana's house is in and Rick Moranis's.
So he's basically it's already ready to harness this like entity,
right,
like the
it was all meant to do this. So so they have to get to the top of that building, which is where the satellite thing is,
and where it's all fucking going down. So right. Yeah, where they release all the entities, or they release all the ghosts, and they kind of like, right, isn't it, they all kind of conjure in that location because of that,
right.
And it's like this fucking insane shit's going on top of this building, which is really cool, like miniature effects and shit. I think at some point they do it looks like a helicopter shot, but it's really, I think, just miniatures.
Yeah, they built an entire replica of New York City in at 3-foot scale for that scene and like the Stay Puft scenes.
That's so good.
Entire downtown Manhattan. I mean, like it's pretty incredible.
It's insane. But, they and so they show up the Ghostbusters, which is kind of weird. I think, isn't Winston not with them when
Church?
They do this part? Why did I?
Yeah, he is.
He is.
He is. He's with Ray. They're out on a service call. They're talking in the car and they talk about God.
That's the wrong
and
mouse.
Listen up. Whitley's bugging out the system. Anyways, they show up.
They're together. Yeah, they show up. Well, they both lose. They lose. Lewis, and they lose Dana. They both take off.
Yeah.
Bill Murray loses Dana. They take off. And after they find out that that's where they needed to go, they wind up luring them up to this rooftop.
And they approach it, and it's this fucking insane, psychedelic, like, it almost looks like a gate to heaven, but it's not. It's like some weird, spiritual, bright gateway
portal thing. Yeah.
It's so dope. It's probably the coolest part of the movie.
The lady who plays the Goza character.
Oh, the like god of.
Her name is Slavica Jovan.
Yes. And she couldn't speak English, so they had somebody else do it and mess with the voice. Also, Ivan Reitman, the
director, right?
He is the voice of Dana. When she says there's no data on this wall, they just slowed his voice down, and he's also the voice of Slimer, like all the weird noises.
That's awesome.
But so when Gozer shows up, which is like, you know, the androgynous ghost lady person, the main god person,
red eyes, right? The red.
Yes. Originally, that was supposed to be Ivo Shandor. Like the ghost of the guy that made all of this happen, and they were like, well, we should have it be a woman. And then Harold Ramis was like, well, we how about we go like in between something androgynous? And he goes, something originally Evo Shander was based off of David Byrne from the Talking Heads.
Weird. Yeah.
And so that's why their hair is like that, or Gozer's hair is like that, because it's supposed to be like David Byrne. But he was like, less David Byrne, more David Bowie.
So it does feel very David Bowie.
Ziggy look Stardust. Pretty close, yeah. So there you go.
And yeah, so she says, "Are you something like, are you a god?
Are you a god?"
And Bill Murray says something like, "No."
No, Ray says, right? "No."
I love that, like, these people or, like, these entities, like, who don't understand anything. Like, they are always like, "Are you so-and-so?" And then, like, they're so trusting. Like, they don't understand. That's like, how can you take over, the world?
I'll say this. I get you, but I feel like that's what makes this movie so charming, is it? Because it feels like...
It's so absurd.
It feels like kids making up make-believe as it goes along sometimes, where it's like, this feels like, oh, we're going to go get the big bad guy. And then, like, it just feels like a moment.
Are you a god? Yeah,
are you a god? Like, it seems like something another kid would imitate as the bad guy. And then they're
right.
You know, it feels like Cops and Robbers almost. Yeah. And... But that does make sense. It's like the god would know and wouldn't have to ask.
Yeah, right.
Just point it out, Tanner.
True.
Absolutely. An all infinite, powerful being should probably know. But that's the other thing, too, is like all of the other ghosts know about what, like Slimer knows about like hot dog carts and all, and there's a that's taxi true. Driver one and all this other stuff. But this all,
The mighty one, the big one.
The mighty one is ignorance is bliss, I guess. Yeah. But she says, "Are you a god?" And then Ray says, "No."
Yeah.
And then she goes, she goes, "Then die!" And she, shocks him and shit like that. And afterwards, Winston's character, Winston.
Yeah.
He says, "Ray, when somebody asks you if you're a god, you say yes."
Yeah. Just got the shit shocked out of them.
Yeah. And they try to reason.
They get they gas themselves up on the next approach. They are like, we're the fucking Ghostbusters.
Yeah. All
right, who's this bitch? And they like,
"Come into my town."
They do something. They have their whole
life. Yeah.
And they like flip their things on and
ready to cross streams.
Yeah. And they're like, "We know." Well, yeah, that's the thing. Do they don't cross streams yet, right?
No.
Not yet.
They take a game, like they're getting defeated and then they're like, "All right, it's toss up."
Yeah.
They shoot at her and then she shocks back at him, right?
Yeah.
And they're sitting there trying to regroup and she goes, "Okay. I know this whole thing verbatim because Aubrey knows, my daughter knows this verbatim, and it's so funny to hear her say it." She goes, "Choose the form of the destructor."
Yeah.
And they're all like, "What? Like, what does that mean? Blah, blah, blah." And I found out, okay, so like if you watch the movie, she says, "Choose the form of the destructor." And then Bill Murray goes, "We don't know what that means." Blah, blah. They cut a tiny bit out because they could use this line, but he says something like, she says, "Choose a form of destructor," and then Bill Murray says, "Jews and peanut butter?" Because we don't know what that means. And then they cut out the Jews and peanut butter to where it just says, "We don't know what that means."
Oh, is it because the actress couldn't speak very good? Is that part of that too? That
she couldn't speak very good English? Right. Exactly. So they figure out like what she's trying to do. They're like, "Oh, clear your heads, don't think of anything.
Because they'll take control of it." Yeah.
And then it's silent, and then you hear Aubrey's favorite line. The form has been chosen. The traveler has come. And then it goes to Ray. They all start, "I didn't think of anything. Did you think of anything?"
Yeah, they're all confident.
They all just start looking at Ray. And he's just sitting there. He's like, it just popped in there. What popped in there, Ray? It's the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man. And that's when Stay Puft comes on.
He tried to think of something that would not, could, there's no possible way that it could be a destructive thing, like a,
yes,
like a, yes, bad thing.
That's what he says. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But then it absolutely is. It's like, completely, yeah, it's like Godzilla, and it's like this.
He said, giant. He said he tried thinking of camping on Lake Minnetonka and roasting marshmallows over a fire, and then it wound
up.
Oh,
but
yeah, yeah.
I think they said it was the inspiration for like that the Stay Puft was Michelin Man and what else? Michelin Man and
Pillsbury Doughboy.
Pillsbury Doughboy.
And then there was like some like old marshmallow company that legit had a, like, it was called the Stay Puffed Marshmallow Man, but like it was like
not
the brand name version. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But just basically something that could never be like evil or demonic or anything like that.
No, and yeah.
Originally, it was supposed to be like this giant like typhoon of spirit, like the same stuff they were shooting out whenever, like a big typhoon of that with giant aphids that would like eat people's heads off.
Oh god.
They were like, oh, that's pretty dark, so they went with the Stay Puft marshmallow.
That's so awesome. Yeah. And it does look really good. I read that one of the things they were most worried about was that scene looking good, because it's such a ridiculous situation where it's like a giant marshmallow man walking around New York. And they were like, we have to nail this because it's like the movie. Like, this is the big moment. And like, it does, it holds up, dude. That scene.
I mean, they did so pretty good. Damn well with it. Yeah. 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 It looks they had to, good. I know the actor was inside of it. The original person that was inside of this. So there were like three of those suits.
Yeah.
$20,000 a piece. And they burned two of the three.
$60,000 in marshmallow suits.
The original dude that was inside the suit, I can't remember if he got burned or if it, like, because they were torching the suit, and the suit's made of, like, foam rubber stuff, so on the inside of the suit, this dude's just straight inhaling, like, rubber fumes. He quit, and they got another guy that, I guess, I think they wound up putting, like, an air hose up into it to where he could
breathe. Those were the good days of special effects.
Yeah, yeah.
Just giving people just lung damage for the rest of
their life. You imagine being the dude known for dying inside of the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man suit. Just because you wanted a good shot. All for the shot. But, so.
This is when they cross streams, right? Yes. They finally realize, they're like, oh, and he says, I'm certain that we, what's he say? Like, I'm certain that we, forget, he basically says he's certain that they will like almost not die.
Oh yeah,
or something and it's a very like
99% sure that, you know, I think he says something to like the effect of like 99% sure that it's going to end in like a nuclear holocaust, but they got to do it anyway, or something like that.
They really fucking risk it, and they blast them, they cross the streams, and it's really cool. They show them melt, like Joey's talked about, they show the actual suit melt a bit, and there's this giant, it's funny, here's what the one thing, the one special effect that doesn't look that great is the explosion. The explosion does just look like a video of an explosion put on top of a city building.
Guess what? That's exactly what it is. They literally superimposed it on top and and shot, they had like cannons of shaving cream, but they like, so they had the scene, they superimposed the explosion, and then just shot cannons of like shaving cream out the side. So it just looked, you know, it doesn't look that great. But
it's funny because everything up leading up to that is so good.
Yeah, and there's like this the part where they actually, like, right before he explodes, it's the Stay Puft's face, and it goes like, I like, it's almost like Threshold.
I know
super bright colors, like it's like a nuclear like thing going off or something like that. It's like eyes go all hollow and then it blows up. It's pretty cool, but then the
following is cool. Yeah, just like this video of an explosion.
Hiroshima, basically, in the middle.
But and then they're the fucking heroes.
They win the day.
Sigourney Weaver gives a smooch to Bill Murray, which she's always kind of been like standoffish because, you know, in a smart way, because he's definitely very creepy in the beginning of the movie, but he's like this actual Ghostbuster now, and it's a happy ending.
He proved himself.
They busted the ghost, but you do, at the end of the scene, it's all celebratory, but a slime guy goes towards the camera. We know didn't get them all, didn't bust all the ghosts.
They busted it wide open, but they didn't bring them all back.
Yeah.
That's right.
You know, like that song?
No, I don't.
You know, bust it wide open.
And we'll throw that song in there.
Yeah.
But that's Ghostbusters. We've been going for a hot minute. What's everybody's? I know Joey's. Joey's is. It's probably on your. It's on your top what? Top 10? Top 5? What do you think? Top 20?
Top 5.
One of his top 5 favorite movies.
Well, so, man, I mean.
That's tricky.
I don't know. That's so hard. I tried doing that the other day, and it took me 45 minutes just to get
there. I've tried to do it before where you sit down with a piece of paper and you're like, okay, 5 movies. Dude. What are the best? It's hard.
You got to factor in. So another thing about this movie that I absolutely fucking love.
Yeah.
Is the music in this movie. Like the actual score. Not like the Ghostbuster song and all of that, but like the score in it. There's a lot of theremin. And then a lot of piano and like light things when it needs to be.
Can you think of a certain scene where like the song or the music is really good? Maybe we can throw in that into the podcast. Is it like
that one earlier?
Yeah. Well, what part?
Oh, that's an actual song in that scene in the montage, or when they all the ghosts go everywhere. I think the song is called Dreams, but it's not the Cranberries' Dreams.
It's just like a. Oh yeah. A little later in the timeline.
But I'm trying to think when they're in the basement, of the library, the very beginning,
and that, they're going through. And I was thinking that too.
The slime. It like whenever spooky they see like spooky stuff. There's like weird theremin. I'll have to send it to you because there's like parts where it's just like lighthearted parts, and the piano's really cool. It's like ba-dum-ba-dum-ba-dum-ba-dum-ba-dum. I don't know. I don't even know who did the score for that, but really well done.
So I think it was great. Whitley, we talked about this. I think it is very much like for boys, but what'd you think overall of the movie? Like, we'll start with maybe just the movie in general. What did you think?
Definitely not as enthusiastic about it as Joey. I mean, I think it was just like, it's always just like been a movie that like
just in pop culture,
you know what I mean? So it's like, oh, that's Ghostbusters. I don't know, like I've never been like super excited about it, except I think I remember the second one more than I do the first one.
Kind of makes sense.
Like, I feel like the second one, I would watch that one. I think I need to watch that one.
Maybe we should
watch it. I mean, it was good. It was nice to revisit it. I enjoyed, like, the effects. I appreciated it. But,
humor-wise, you probably didn't. You probably didn't get as much as...
It wasn't, like, a knee slapper for me. No. You know, like, I got the jokes, but, like, it wasn't, like, a... The funniest movie I've ever seen. But I think stuff like Dodgeball and Hot Rod is hilarious.
That's the thing. That's kind of tricky. It's like Whitley loves Hot Rod and Dodgeball, which are very similar.
Like scary movie. Like, I love very dumb.
Yeah. Scary movie is one of her favorite movies.
This movie is such like a big, and I mentioned it before, is like, this is like the movie between me and my dad. I mean, there's like a couple Gene Wilder movies, but like this one, Dad and I, you know, and
special film. It's a special
but
film.
I feel
yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
I feel like all my guy friends like love Ghostbusters too.
It is.
They love Ghostbusters. And I'm just like, I don't understand that. So maybe they also have like some thing growing up, like it had
it's just some special thing.
Yeah.
Dad goes to the blockbuster.
Because everybody, I mean, like everybody around our age, our parents,
yeah,
that was the time frame. You know, I mean, my dad was 20, 25 when Ghostbusters came out, something like that.
Wow.
Yeah.
Or something. Yeah, yeah, 25. So it was hot shit for him. And like, I mean, also the time period, all of those people were on either Saturday Night Live or SCTV.
True. Very much that humor,
it was,
too.
It was hot shit. I mean, that was the humor of the era. But
I feel like all my friends really love Bill Murray, too. Mm-hmm. I'm like, Bill Murray's funny, but he's like, he's very dry.
Yeah.
You know? And so it's like, that's the thing. It's like, I get it and I appreciate it and I think he's funny, but he's not like, I'm not going to cackle like a witch over him.
But the more
it's subtle. So you have to like think about it. Sometimes.
I get it. With Bill Murray, I kind of like watching this, I kind of get his whole thing more. I know people, it's either you love him or you hate him kind of thing, but like, I kind of like him because he almost seems like he's not even really doing the movie. Because he just kind of feels like he showed up and he's like, oh, so it's a ghost. And it's just like, that's what's kind of funny about him. Because he's just like, it feels like he just showed up the day of, and it's like, he's just kind of doing he's doing the motions of what the movie is.
So he said he would do this movie if he was able to, I can't remember the name of the movie off the top of my head, but he wanted to do a remake of an old movie and it was like a serious role for him. And that was the only way he said he would do Ghostbusters is if they let him do this other movie. And so it could have been just like him phoning it in so he could get the other, you know, the other movie made. He made the other movie and it completely bombed.
You know what's funny is when they contacted Bill Murray, because okay, I don't know this or not, but doesn't his character die off eventually in the trilogy of the movies? Or like the
Harold Ramis does.
Oh, because he actually dies, right?
He actually dies, yeah.
So, but doesn't... I think I read somewhere that Bill Murray wasn't really stoked on doing a second movie, or...
No.
Right,
well, he didn't really want to... they had to convince him to do the second one. The second one bombed. I mean, it was like...
Right.
People went to see it because of Ghostbusters, but... It was popular, then it dropped off just because it wasn't as good as the first one. But... The third one, the one that just came out like last year, the like super new age one. So Ernie Hudson and Bill Murray and Dan Aykroyd are all in that one. Spoiler alert, if you haven't seen it. It's been out long enough. I don't give a shit.
Yeah.
If you like Ghostbusters, go fucking see the movie. But they had to convince them real hard because they wouldn't even do the one that was before that, like the all-female one. They were written into that, but Bill Murray wouldn't do it just because he's been waiting for... There's been like four or five attempts to make Ghostbusters 3. None of them wrote a good enough script, I think, and he was waiting for that. Like, I've seen the most recent one, and it does a pretty good job of like okay, so Ivan Reitman did Ghostbusters,
right?
And then Jason Reitman, right, the son. He did this Ghostbusters, the new one.
Oh, that's cool.
I didn't know that. And he was a little kid on the set of the original Ghostbusters, so he was there all that stuff. And he put like the demon dog thing show up in the new one, and it's not, he used CGI, but he made it look like the practical effect, like claymation dog
thing, like in the first one.
And the same, like the proton shoot, you know, lasers or whatever,
the
and
beams
the spirits and everything. It all looks like it's like the original one. Like it looks vintage,
man.
So it's super cool. And there's a lot of callbacks and things like that. But like, does it match up to the original Ghostbusters? No. They all wind up in the end of it, which is pretty cool. And Harold Ramis is a ghost in that one. So.
So they put him as a ghost, literally, in the... That's crazy. almost like a Paul Walker in Fast and the Furious, where they like.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, like, honestly, like, I mean, so I'm like a diehard Ghostbusters fan.
Yeah.
And when I went to see that, and when he actually shows up at like the end of the movie, goes, like, damn, man.
Yeah. But, that's heavy.
Yeah. It's pretty, it was pretty epic. It was pretty epic.
That is cool. So yeah, I'll say it's great. I liked it a lot. I had a lot of fun watching it.
For the time period it was, it's great. It, like, is it my favorite comedy of all time? No. But for that time period, yeah, for sure. It beats out Beverly Hills Cop.
Yeah. Although that's hard for me to say because I watched a lot of Beverly. It's funny. In a way, Beverly Hills Cop was my Ghostbusters. So I watched that quite a bit. My dad showed me Beverly Hills Cop, and it was like that so thing.
Your Bill Murray was Judge Reinhold.
Is that his name?
yeah, I'm pretty sure.
Oh, my God. I just, that laugh he does and everything.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, so that's, I mean, like, I've seen Beverly Hills Cop a couple times, but, like, Judge Reinhold, he's the dude that's in the Santa Claus, right? He's the psychiatrist stepdad.
Oh, yeah.
Same guy? Yeah.
He doesn't like Eddie Murphy, but then like they end up being buddies. It's like a buddy cop movie eventually. So yeah, that's a fucking pod. We did it, guys. You know, we're cooking at this point. We did Ghostbusters. Now we're going into the actual clamshell of the clubhouse.
The clamshells.
With that, because...
Oh, let's just say our goodbyes.
Oh, bye.
Hasta la vista.
See you later.
Thanks. I collect mold, spores, and fungi.
Yes.
It's time to take a trip inside of your VCR.